Hello and welcome to the Newly in Friends. Today we will be discussing on the problems faced by arsenic contamination. This is a very major issue impacting various states like Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, West Bengal. And this is an issue which, despite its importance, is less spoken about, and there is much less awareness about it than there should be. We also see a lack of political will to kind of do something about this problem. And because of this problem, millions of people living in the Gangetic Plains in these affected states are also facing a majority of health problems, including the grave concern of cancer. It is very important for us to know more about this topic, discuss the various challenges that this problem is facing before the population of India, and the kind of things that the policy research action groups are doing in this domain, and how the government, for example, is coming up with new policies targeted to change the kind of situation that arsenic contamination is bringing about for the people living in the Gangetic Plains. And to discuss on this very important and significant issue, we have with us Dr. Ruchi Shree. Dr. Ruchi Shree is the assistant professor at the PG Department of Political Science, TMBU, Bhagalpur. Her areas of interest include the politics of water as a natural resource, social and environmental movements, and the politics of development. Through her interdisciplinary research on politics of water, she has been exploring its various aspects, such as the politics of perspectives, the role of civil society organization, the challenges posed by the privatization, and traditional knowledge systems around water conservation. Along with teaching, she has been actively involved in research advocacy with environmental organizations such as Environmental Law Research Society, Kalpavriksha, and the SANDRP. Among her publications are works on sanitation and state planning and mapping water disputes in India. At present, she is part of an ongoing research project with the Michigan State University, USA. I thank you, Ruchi, once again for having taken out the time to talk to us today. The first question that I would want to know from you is that India is a country where the largest section of the population, both in rural as well as urban areas, is dependent on groundwater. And we are seeing how with extensive irrigation, industrial, urban, rural use, the water in several areas in the Gangetic Plains and elsewhere also in India is becoming contaminated and polluted. And if we were to talk about the Gangetic Plains specifically, we see how the problem of arsenic pollution is coming up in a big way. In fact, if I were to quote from a report that was published in 2017 by the CNN, we would know that 239 million people spread across 153 districts in 21 states of India are drinking water which is contaminated with arsenic. So Ruchi Shree, the first thing that I would want you to do for us is please explain what is arsenic contamination and why is it such a big challenge before India?
First of all, thank you so much, Ananya, to have invited me to speak. And here I would like to thank the team of New Leem, because my first writing on arsenic was all thanks to the New Leem to have asked me to write about it. And then recently, I was benefited by having a very close interaction with Dr. Ashok Ghosh, who is the head of Mahavir Cancer Research Institute, as well as the Bihar Pollution Control Board. To begin with, I would like to say that arsenic poisoning, we may consider it as a process of contamination, which is about, say, groundwater, and how it also affects the food chain. So arsenic is not only affecting the groundwater, but how is it entering into our food chain? And one of the biggest problem with the arsenic contamination is that the number of cancer cases is rising very, very high in this region. And it's not just in the Ganga Basin, but I was told by Professor Ghosh that we should be concerned about the GBM, that is Ganga, Brahmaputra, and Meghna, these three river basin and this entire area is affected due to arsenic contamination. And in fact, we should also tell our viewers that it is not just India, but rather arsenic has now become a global problem. And that's why recently a report had also come which says arsenic, the title is Arsenic in Groundwater, a Global Crisis 2020. So what has happened is that at present, numerous researches are going on in different countries. And but I would like to stress that most of the researches happen to be the scientific ones. And social sciences, we are not engaging as much as we should. And we should also tell our viewers that it is not just arsenic, but there are other contaminated things like nitrate, fluoride, pesticides, iron. So our contamination of groundwater is something which is, you know, from area to area, we will come across these are the different pollutants which are affecting our groundwater.
You made certain extremely important observations, and it's interesting to see how this is a problem which is plaguing the Gangetic plains apart from other river basins as well. And what surprises me is that this is not something which India has recently come to terms with. This is something which has been researched upon, and various scientific and medical bodies have reminded us time and again that this problem does exist in your country, and it can be lethal for people who live in those belts, because their primary resource for water is the groundwater available to them through these rivers, which happen to be contaminated. Now, one of the things that I want to know from you is that why is there a sustained political apathy towards this crisis, and why is there such less awareness about the problem? Has enough not been done up in these regards?
So that I would like to link to the, you can say, the generalized thing that if you look at the ratio of GDP, that the expenditure on sectors like health and education, it happens to be less. And what we get to see about this arsenic issue is also directly related to that only. And also if we look at, because safe drinking water is something which happens to be the part of sustainable development goals. So that was, it should be one of the prime concerns, but we don't get to see that. So if we consider water as something which should be human right, as a corollary to right to life, so that is no access to clean drinking water is something which is a direct threat to human being all over India in general, and then this particular area which is affected by more by the arsenic pollution much more. And this apathy is something which is not just by the like these states which are affected, but even at the level of center, not much has been done.
Yeah, and this brings me to another very important point, that keeping the water dirty can also help companies that sell packaged water. Because when we talk about resource geopolitics, we also see how sustained governmental apathy is also can also be seen in terms of how that helps corporate bodies to kind of pool into that resource and sell their produce in that guard. Because people who are living in the urban parts of these arsenic affected areas would perhaps install a Kent or an RO to kind of deal with that water problem. But the poor marginalized sections of the population will be left drinking this contaminated water without perhaps even knowing that they shouldn't be doing so, or the kind of implications that this could have on their heads. So would you also see it as a deliberate attempt on part of authorities to kind of keep the crisis going, to kind of help an industry which is booming, the packaged water industry?
I very much agree with all that you are saying. And that's what exactly I call politics of perspectives, how this perspective of commodity is being pushed. Because water is something which we considered as commons for a very long time, and it happens to be part of the collective consciousness. So be it the rivers, ponds, now ponds are no more there. We are just this land mafia. We want to have more and more land. So the ponds have been filled. And we see that the rivers are having frequent floods are there. So what is happening is that if we look at even this issue, there is a larger politics of that. And what you are saying, pushing the market, is one. And there are numerous other things also which we need to take into consideration. For example, the history goes back to when we went for the tube wells and how the groundwater extraction increased. So the amount of going deeper for the, like, taking out the water, the amount of extraction kept increasing. And in the same proportion, this problem of arsenic contamination has also increased. And no wonder even this RO industry and other things are very much responsible for that. So we can actually say that there is a class dimension as well for this arsenic Right. contamination also. So who are the most vulnerable section of the society will be the ones who will be affected the most.
I think you've made an extremely important point by breaking in the class dimension, because unless we look at the class dimension of resource geopolitics, we leave out a very important indicator of how this is made to happen from generation to generation, even while research and medical bodies have kept on warning us about what it could do and what it has been doing for so many decades. Related to that, I also wanted to ask from you that arsenic polluted water and its usage has also been responsible for a host of bodily problems and ailments, including something as grave as cancer. Can you please throw a little bit of light on that?
Yeah, so for that, the term that we use is called arsenikos. Arsenikos is the term which is used for the health effects related to the presence of arsenic in drinking water. And it causes numerous health problems, cancer being the most grave one. But from skin infection to developmental problem, even heart diseases, and among different kinds of cancer, the most rampant ones are for gallbladder, then liver and lung. These are the areas which are likely to be affected the most. And if I would like to give you some data that in Mahavir Cancer Research Institute, two kinds of cases of cancer, which is skin and gallbladder. These two are the maximum number of cases that they have registered in last few years. So I would like to stress upon this that the arsenic contamination happens to impact almost every part of the body. So what I would like to say is that arsenic is something we should consider as a slow poison, which affects the people who consume the water contaminated with arsenic. And even hair and nail, these are the two body parts on which its impact can be seen more easily. I mean, the effect gets visible. If the duration is longer, then these are the areas which are affected the most.
Okay, so when we look at the number of cancer patients who have had cancer because of consuming such water, I mean, I think within that population also, we would see the largest representation of those patients who come from backgrounds which are more marginalized or poor backgrounds. So, when this happens, it also highlights for us an entire new spectrum through which we can look at this problem, because this is not then just a problem which the medical fraternity should deal with. It's a problem which is very much ingrained in our social hierarchies, in the way that society is ordained. So, like, for example, people who do not have access to clean water or packaged drinking water or don't have ROs at home, does the medical fraternity or, for example, research show any possibilities of kind of reducing the impact on water without the usage of external technologies? I mean, is there something which people from the poorest of backgrounds can still do about the water to make it less contaminated, without kind of having to spend too much?
What I would like to tell you is that I got to know that in some areas, this government of Bihar, they have put up some water ATMs. So what has happened is that they are trying to provide safe water, drinking water to the people. But there is problem with the maintenance of those ATMs. So sometimes what happens is that even if a certain plant is fixed, then they are not maintained properly. So I think somewhere the community awareness is also very important, because people also need to come forward, and we cannot think that just the state will give do everything for us. So community awareness is needed, one, and then probably they need to come together in order to find the ways to reach for the poor section of the society.
Yeah, and coming to the issue that you raised about the need for the community itself to kind of take things into their hands and kind of speak up for this problem. We recently saw the assembly elections unfold in Bihar. And although education and employment did become issues which were talked about in political agendas of various political parties, but we still did not see the problem of arsenic contamination being taken up with that kind of sincerity, or that being seen as an electoral agenda at all. Why do you think this happens? Because this is something which people across castes and class are grappling with on a day-to-day basis. This is a problem which is very, very real. Why do you still think that no kind of political mobilization has happened on such a grave issue?
For that, I would like to say I recently wrote a piece in Hindi and I have sent it to a newspaper, which I have titled as Paryavaran aur Rajniti ke Badalte Mapdand. So in that, I have precisely written about this issue, that probably politics has been, you know, keeping environment at a bay for a very long time. But no more we can do the same for a longer time, because Delhi has polluted air and most of these areas has polluted water. So what is happening is that after water purifier, now we are buying air purifier. So I would also like to say that it is about, we are moving into a more individualistic society. You want to keep your house clean with clean air, clean water. But the moment you will step outside, you are not safe. So that way is like, how long can we just, you know, keep these issues not taking consideration of them? I don't think so that we can actually do that for a very long time. Probably politics would have to take these issues more seriously. And environment is likely to become a major issue in next few years for sure. We cannot go ahead like this for a very long time.
Yeah, let's hope that, because otherwise we only see people taking up very individualized solutions to environmental problems, and that too entirely determined by one's access to resources, and a host of people who are on the margins are left to mercy. And these are the people who stand to be most affected by problems such as contaminated water, because they have no alternatives. Now, as someone who has very, very closely been involved in environmental advocacy, you're also a political scientist, and at present you are in Bihar. We know that institutions like the Mahavir Institute of Research has worked extensively and for decades on what arsenic contaminated water does to patients, the kind of ailments that are born as a result. And Bihar again is one of the states which is the most highly affected by arsenic contamination, and yet it is one of the states which has done the least about it. So can you just highlight for our viewers as to how grave the crisis is in the state of Bihar particularly?
I would like to point out two things. One is that in the year 2014, this arsenic map of Bihar had come up, which has highlighted that 18 districts are severely affected. And I would like to name four districts which have the highest value. First is Buxar, then Bhojpur, then Patna and Bhagalpur. And if I would like to tell you the amount, because the WHO, World Health Organization, says that 5 ppb, that is per billion, so which is permissible limit is 5, and for India, Indian government wants to keep it 10. And in these districts, it happens to be somewhere much above, say, 1500. So you can just imagine what WHO is saying and what we have in Bihar. So that is one. And another thing I wanted to tell you is about the gender dimension, how the women are the most vulnerable section, because if they have to commute to a far off distance to get a for like safe drinking water. So how, in order to save their time, they like, even if they know that it is arsenic contaminated, but in order to save themselves from, say, walking miles to get the safe drinking water, they at times are dependent on these. And even the school going children, many of them have to drop out. And again, there is this gender dimension that the women and the girls of the family are the ones who are responsible for, like, you know, getting this drinking water for the family. So certainly I would like to say this, that Bihar happens to be one of the most affected one, and as well as West Bengal and UP. And apart from these, Jharkhand, Assam, and Punjab are also the states which are severely affected by arsenic contamination due to being in this GBM basin, Ganga, Brahmaputra, and Meghna basin.
I think those are very remarkable points, wherein you also bring in the dimension of how women, for example, become particularly vulnerable, because in many families, they might be responsible for fetching water from a very long distance apart, and in the absence of other resources, water resources, they might be compelled, even against their will, to kind of fetch water which is contaminated despite knowing about it. Now, you know, something which is extremely important and has come out through our course of discussion is that when we look at an environmental problem as grave as contamination of water with arsenic, we can't just look at it as a gender neutral problem. It is very much ingrained in how both the sexes look at the problem, how they deal with it, and which gender kind of is compelled to deal with it more often despite its wishes. And in this case, it is the women. And they have the whole responsibility of running the household, fetching water, etc. And because they are also cooking by using this water, and this water is also going into their crops. And this means that this problem and the ailments that it is bringing about would get transferred from one generation to the other. And I'm sure that in Bihar and West Bengal, Jharkhand, and the other states which have been affected with this problem, there are generations within the same family which are facing health problems. So could you, like, this will be my last question, could you just highlight the gender dimension of this problem once more for us and kind of bring it across more clearly as to why do you think that we have to look at any environmental crisis also from the lens of gender?
As I mentioned earlier, that gender is something, and since in recent past, now for most of the researches, we are considering gender as being an important dimension of that. And in fact, in coming days, I intend to take up some study, because Bhagalpur happens to be an area which is severely affected by arsenic problem. And here I see that, you know, the problem of water, usually for a state like Bihar, water as such is not much of a problem. Like, we don't pay a bill for water. But I'm sure that the amount that we spend on, say, RO, you have to get that something which is to be changed in every 3 months, which costs you 700, 800 rupees. So I wonder, for example, the women who work as maid, what kind of water do they get? Then also, there is the supply water, something which they get for just an hour or so in the morning. So overall only, their consumption of water is patterned in such a way that they have to consume less water, so that they will go to, like, even the frequency of going to washroom has to be in that way. So how much consumption of water a family has, it's something which is also regulated by how much access you have to water. And then the members of the family, the hierarchy, who will get how much water. For example, if a family has 50 liters of water, and in that the entire household thing is to be managed. So you can just imagine how this gender thing gets very much, you know, the women will be the one who will be using the least amount of water. And also, if it comes to how arsenic is affecting them, because The problem with the groundwater is there with the arsenic. And as I told you earlier also, that they have to go bring water. So in order to minimize that time, at times they just rely upon the water source which is available to them in the nearby locality. So even if they know that this water is not that safe, but since they have their other constraints, so they end up using that water only. And sometimes they don't even have any other option, actually. That also we should know. That something just which is given to them, say an hour of supply of water in the morning or another half an hour in the evening. And here I have seen another interesting thing, which is just on the road, there are some this supply water kind of thing which comes. And just on the road, people have to fill their, water gallons and all. And I have been thinking, don't know how do they cope up and how do they survive on that. And of course, I see only the women doing that work. I have hardly seen a man doing that thing. So the morning and evening, whenever there is this water time, water comes for them. So it's the women and the girls who do that work. So of course, this gender dimension is very much there with water.
I think it's been a very, very meaningful conversation with you, Dr. Ruchishree, and you've raised extremely important points on this extremely important issue, which is seldom talked about, and there is far, far less awareness about it than there should be. We have also spoken about the lack of political will to change things for the people living in the Gangetic Basin. We have spoken about the gendered and dimension of this problem. And you have also highlighted that this is a problem which affects people lower down the social hierarchy scale. And the more vulnerable the community, the more it is likely to kind of get exposed to arsenic contaminated water. I think it's been a very, very meaningful conversation, and you've brought about important aspects to this problem and beautifully put this up before our listeners. Thank you so much, Ruchishree, for taking out the time to be with us today. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, the team Newly, to have given me a chance to interact. Thank you so much.